What we're going to talk about this morning as we continue to take our look at the enemy. We're wrapping up the series this morning. We're going to look this morning how our enemy Satan is defeated. How he's defeated in our daily lives, but also how he's defeated forever and ever. A couple weeks ago, we looked at the different descriptions of Satan that's given to us in Scripture. We saw how at one time he was an angel, and how he convinced a third of the angels to rebel against God, caused war in heaven. But he lost that war. He was cast down to the earth. We saw different names that were given to Satan throughout Scripture. The devil, the dragon, the serpent, Satan, Lucifer, Morning Star, the Father of Lies, and other descriptions, other names, but it doesn't really matter what you call him. He's very real, very powerful, and he's very dangerous. He roams the earth looking to attack anybody who sides with Christ. He uses whatever tactics he can use to win a battle. We need to be aware of those tactics, because Satan is not going to fight fair. He uses temptation as one of his greatest weapons. And last week we looked at how Jesus was tempted in the desert after he fasted and prayed for 40 days. We looked at how Jesus handled that temptation and how we too can handle that temptation. We saw that Satan will tempt us in three very vital areas of our lives. Physical needs and desires, pride and possessions and power. Satan attempted to tempt Jesus in these three areas, but Jesus was able to withstand these temptations by standing on the Word of God. It's important for us to learn and to know Scripture, because it will help us to stand strong against temptation, especially when Scripture is twisted to try and tempt us. A couple weeks ago, when we were looking at Satan and who he was, we see that he can masquerade as an angel of light. He can appear as an angel of light. It's important for us to know that Satan knows the Bible. He knows it better than a lot of Christians. And he will twist it to try and tempt us. God's Word will help equip us to deal with any circumstances that life throws at us, including temptation. See, Jesus used Scripture to combat Satan's attempt at temptation, and we can and we must do the same thing. Temptation in itself is not sin until our desires turn into action. And if we continue in the temptation, we begin to make it part of our life, and that can lead us to spiritual death and eventually to eternal punishment. Temptation is hard to resist. When we give in and we fail, it can lead us down the path to destruction. But this morning we're turning the page a little bit. This morning we're turning the page on Satan. When he tempts us, and sometimes we give in, it's important for us to understand that we have victory. We have victory in our daily lives, and we have victory for eternity. We must always, however, be prepared for battle. Charles Swindoll wrote, "Some time ago, the Fighting Irish of Notre Dame played in their home court and had the audacity to whip the Bruins of UCLA. Digger Phelps, the coach of that Notre Dame team, said, 'The victory is sweet, but unfortunately, in a short period of time, we will have to go to Pauley Pavilion and battle them on their own court.' And everyone in California shouted, 'Amen,' when he made that statement. And sure enough, in a very short time, every sports fan in the area watched UCLA on their home court soundly defeat the Fighting Irish. You may win the battle, but there's always another one to fight another day." When we know that, we may win a battle today, but there's going to be another battle with Satan tomorrow. We must be prepared every day of our lives because he's going to attack. He will attack us when we're tired, when we're weak, when we're most vulnerable. But if we're ready, even then we can stand in victory. And the best way to prepare for battle is to have the necessary equipment. The necessary equipment is armor. And it's God's armor. We find it in Ephesians chapter 6, reading verse 10 through 13. It says, "Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God, so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground, and after you have done everything, to stand." Then when he was chained to a Roman soldier in prison, Paul wrote about the armor of God. This armor will help us to stand strong against Satan's attacks. We need to understand, though, that the war is a spiritual war. It's not a physical war. By understanding that, we understand that the armor is spiritual. It's not physical. But remember how I said that Satan is very powerful. Because he's very powerful, it takes a very powerful army to stand against his attacks. And there's no better armor that we can put on as part of God's army than God's armor. When Satan attacks even the weak and the tired, and they put on God's army, it will help us, God's armor, it will help us to stand strong against his attacks. In the following verses, we're not going to read them, but I'm going to give you a synopsis of them. Paul talks, and he describes the armor of God. The first thing that he talked about was the belt of truth. The truth of Jesus Christ, which helps to protect us against the lies that Satan will tell us. And he talked about the breastplate of righteousness, which protects our hearts, which helps us to remember that we need to live and that we do live in the righteousness of Christ. Talked about the gospel of peace, our shoes that help us to walk in the peace of Christ and help us to stand on the promises of God. Then he talked about the shield of faith, which will repel the arrows of temptation that Satan will fire at us. He talked about the helmet of salvation next, which will help us to remember that we live according to God's values, not the values of the world. All this is defensive armor, but then he started talking about offensive armor. And he talked about the sword of the Spirit. The sword of the Spirit is the same sword that Jesus used when he was tempted in the desert. And the sword of the Spirit is the Word of God. It cuts our hearts and our souls with the truth of the gospel. It tells us how to live. It tells us how to follow Christ. And it can help us to defend ourselves when Satan attacks and he uses Scripture and twists Scripture to make it sound like it's all right. And then finally, Paul talks about prayer. While it's not necessarily a part of the armor of God, it's a very effective and very powerful weapon that we have. When we have on God's armor and we reach out to him in prayer, when we're being attacked, he'll give us his strength to stand strong. He'll give us his peace in the darkness of the fight. And it'll help us to stand strong no matter what Satan throws at us. When we put on God's armor and we pray, and he gives us his strength, we can stand against anything and everything that Satan can throw at us. And we're going to win the battle. In 1 John chapter 4 and verse 4 we read, "You, dear children, are from God and have overcome them, because the one who is in you is greater than the one who is in the world." Not only do we have God's armor, but we have God Himself. Our God, our Savior Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit, the three parts of the Holy Trinity are greater than all of Satan's forces combined. Because we have the Holy Spirit living with us, within us, Christ lives within us, and He alone is greater than Satan's forces. Because God is greater. Because Christ is greater. Because the Holy Spirit is greater, we can have victory over everything and anything that Satan throws on. However, we must understand that this is a daily battle. This isn't a once a week, or once a month, or once a year, or once a lifetime battle. These battles happen daily. Satan's not going to take a day off. We may take a day off. According to Scripture, we call it the Sabbath. But Satan does no such thing. Therefore, even on our Sabbath, on our day of rest, we better remember to put on the armor of God. When we're tired, when we're weak, it's when Satan is going to attack the most. But if we're prepared, we're ready for battle, and God strengthens us, God will give us the victory. Again, we need to remember that people, Satan will use people to attack us, but our battle is not against them. It's against Satan and his dark forces. And the armor of God is our best battle plan against his attacks. We need to remember to put on that armor every single day. Sometimes, because we remember to put on that armor, we can avoid the battle altogether. When Satan comes to attack, we can resist him. When he sees that we're ready for battle and that he's outnumbered, he'll flee. James chapter 4, verse 7 says, "Submit yourself then to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you." Understand, when we're working hard for God, Satan is going to attack. When we're following God's will in our lives, Satan is going to attack. When we're following God's will in our church, Satan is going to attack. But when he sees that we're ready for battle, we've submitted ourselves to God, God has given us his armor, and not only when it does, when we have his armor, we also have his army. Satan sees that he's about to get into a battle that he can't win, he's going to flee. We read in the Old Testament about battles that are won before they even begin because the attacking army sees how strong and prepared the opposing army is, and they flee instead of attack. Our battles with Satan can be the same way. When he attacks and he sees all we have on the armor of God, and God's army is standing with us, he will flee instead of attacking. The best defense against our enemy is a good offense. And our offense, when it's rested in God, will cause Satan to flee. He's not going to stick around to lose a battle. That's why we shouldn't try to fight any spiritual battle without being prepared. And even if we're not in a battle, we need to be ready for one. 1 Peter chapter 5, verses 8 and 9 says, "Be self-controlled and alert. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. Resist him, standing firm in the faith, because you know that your brothers throughout the world are undergoing the same kind of sufferings. See, by being self-controlled, we remember to put on the armor of God every day. We remember to be prepared every day. Being alert means that we never let our guard down. See, sometimes, because we know and understand the power of the armor of God, we can feel over-secure, overconfident. We put on the armor in the morning, but we forget to pray. Forget to pray about the battles of the day, what we're going to face, what others are going to face, we forget. Sometimes we put on the armor and we decide that we'll leave something off. We don't need it. Not only do we forget to pray, but maybe we forget to pick up the Bible and read it today. Maybe we forget the helmet or the peace that God gives us, the breastplate. We forget something or we just don't put it on. We don't need it. We become too relaxed in our walk with God. We become too comfortable with our walk in the world. That is when Satan, the lion, the enemy, is going to attack. See, a lion is not only going to attack a weak and a hurt animal, but he's going to attack a defenseless animal. An animal that's not paying attention. An animal that's not self-controlled and alert. But he's also going to attack an animal, even a strong animal, when he's alone. Even with the armor of God, we need to have other people praying with us and praying for us. Even with the armor of God, we have to remain self-controlled and alert. See, another great and powerful weapon that we have to use against Satan is other believers, our brothers and sisters in Christ. See, a lion usually won't attack an animal that's surrounded by other animals because they can join together and defeat the lion. However, if we allow ourselves to be separated from other Christians, Satan can and will attack. If we try to go at it alone, even the most well-armed soldier can be defeated. Satan is looking for Christians that separate themselves from the church. He's looking for Christians that are spiritually weak. He's prowling. However, when we band together, we stand strong in our faith, we stand strong in the armor of God, we can resist him. He won't attack when he knows he's outnumbered and will be defeated. Together, as Christians, as brothers and sisters in Christ, we can stand together strong against Satan's attacks. When we pray for each other, when we pray for other believers around the world, we're standing with them. We're helping them to overcome the attacks of Satan. We may not even know them. We may not even know what battle they're fighting. But when we pray for them, we're standing with them. We're standing as part of God's army that's defeated Satan already. So we must stand strong together in prayer for each other. We must stand strong in prayer for those that are on the front lines. Now, while defeating Satan in our daily lives is great and it's awesome, it's also important that we understand that the final victory, the final battle, the final war has already been won. In Genesis chapter 3, verses 14 and 15, we read, "So the Lord God said to the serpent, 'Because you have done this, cursed are you above all livestock and all the wild animals. You will crawl on your belly, and you will eat the dust all the days of your life. And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will crush your head, and you will strike his heel. Going all the way back to that fateful day in the Garden of Eden, when man first sinned. Right then and there, God told Satan about his final defeat. Day one of sin, it was announced how sin, how the creator of sin would be defeated. God told him that the woman's offspring, who is Jesus Christ, would crush his head, even though he would strike his heel. That happened about 2,000 years ago. Satan struck at Christ's heel by having Jesus crucified. But just 3 short days later, Jesus struck the final fatal blow to Satan when he rose from the grave.
Amen.
Even though the final battle has yet to occur, Jesus won the war when he rose from that grave. Hebrews chapter 2 verse 14 says, since the children have flesh and blood, he too shared in their humanity, so that by his death he might destroy him who holds the power of death, that is, the devil. Understand that Jesus loved us so much that he stepped down off his throne in heaven. And he came, he was born in the most humble of circumstances. He grew up. He lived a life just like you and I. He worked as a carpenter before he began his ministry. During his life, Jesus faced the same type of temptations that we face today. See, Jesus was human. And he did that so that his death and resurrection would defeat Satan, who brought sin in the world. One of my favorite scriptures is Romans chapter 6, verse 23. It says, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. See, Satan brought sin into the world, thus brought death into the world. But because of his life, his death, and his resurrection, Jesus Christ gives us victory over sin and death. Because Jesus was resurrected, we can trust that we will be resurrected if we've died in the flesh when he returns. But if Jesus comes back before we die, we're also going to be transformed to live with him forever. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 54 through 57, we read, when the perishable has been clothed with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality, then the saying that is written will come true. Death has been swallowed up in the victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. I want you to pay close attention to verse 57. It says, but thanks be to God, he gives us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
See, our perishable, mortal bodies will be transformed into imperishable, immortal bodies, and will have victory over sin and death. The ruler of sin, Satan, will be defeated when we rise from this world. We join Jesus in the air, and we're transformed. It's because of Jesus' life, death, and resurrection that death has no victory, that sin has no sting. Jesus gives us that victory. But there will be one final battle. We read about that battle in Revelation chapter 20, verses 7 through 10. It says, when the 1,000 years are over, Satan will be released from his prison and will go out to deceive the nations in the four corners of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them for battle. In number, They are like the sand on the seashore. They marched across the breadth of the earth, surrounding the camp of God's people, the city he loves. But fire came down from heaven and devoured them. And the devil who deceived them was thrown into the lake of burning sulfur, where the beast and the false prophet had been thrown. They will be tormented day and night, forever and ever. See, here we see the final defeat, the final battle. And when the Apostle John wrote this, he wrote it as if it had already happened. And it has happened. We see the final battle. When we read the end of the story, we who believe in Christ and have accepted Him as our Savior have victory. See, the final battle won't be fought because it's already been won. Satan and his forces were defeated, are defeated, and will be defeated. Satan and his forces and those that reject Christ are thrown into the lake of burning sulfur to be tormented forever. While we live in the glory and the presence of Jesus Christ. Satan is defeated. The battle is over. And we will rejoice with Christ for eternity. Nothing more amazing than that thought. Even though we know how it ends, Satan is still prowling. He's looking for people to devour. He's looking for people to destroy. See, Satan knows he's been defeated. And he wants to take as many people down with him that he can. He will attack Christians. He will attack non-Christians. He'll attack anybody he can attack. He'll attack the weak, the tired, the vulnerable, and the lonely. And even though we know the war is won, and we have victory, we must still be prepared for battle every day. We must put on the whole armor of God and be ready. We must resist his temptations. And we must stand together in prayer, as a community, as a family, to defeat Satan. Because we fight a spiritual battle, not a physical battle, we must rely on God's armor, God's strength, God's peace, and God's army to help us defeat Satan in our daily battle. We cannot do it alone. And we cannot do it when we're unprepared. If we do, we'll lose the battle. And we may even fall from God, which will cause us to lose the war. This morning I ask, are you prepared for battle? Do you put on your armor of God every morning? Do you gather with other believers on a consistent basis? Do you pray with and for the believers? Do you rely on the power of God to resist the enemy? Are you able to stand strong against the attacks of Satan? Are you self-controlled and alert? The battle is already won, but we need to prepare to claim the victory through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Are you prepared this morning?